Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Food System Solutions webinar series. Today's topic will be on innovating for sustainable food systems transformation, scaling success stories beyond technology. As everybody settles into the room, and before we begin our session, we just want to go over a few housekeeping notes. Today's session will be recorded and it will be shared publicly. We will follow up via email with everybody who registered for the event. To share the recording, and you can also find it on our website at unfoodsystemshub.org. We also ask you to please keep yourself on mute unless called upon to take the floor. This ensures everybody can hear what's going on. If you would like to take the floor during the interactive session, we ask you to please click on the raise hand icon in the Zoom bar until you are asked to take the floor. The chat feature is also enabled, so we encourage you to interact, ask questions, and share thoughts and resources with everybody in the group. And lastly, we would like to ask you to rename yourself on Zoom with your name and your organization. This will help us to call upon you to take the floor or to answer your questions directly in the chat. And without further ado, we would like to kick off today's session by handing the floor to the Director of the Office of Innovation at FAO, Mr. Vincent Martin. And Mr. Martin, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for giving me the floor and for giving me this opportunity of moderating this session. We'll have great panelists with us, and we would like to also hear your voices. Just as a matter of introduction, as you know, the food systems are at a crossroad. If we continue as we do, projections suggest that by 2030, we will still see about 590 million people grappling with hunger, equating to 7% of the global population, a figure that is unchanged since 2015. And in the same vein, we expect around 575 million people that will continue to live in extreme poverty by 2030. So on this basis, we can say that business as usual is not an option, and innovation is a way forward. Talking about food system transformation without putting innovation at the center is an oversight, if not a mistake. Now that it's said, and before hearing from our great panelists and from you, I have a few key messages I would like to share with you. The first one is we are here to focus, and our focus extends beyond identifying challenges to finding and implementing effective solutions. Innovation is critical to this discussion, and if one of the many engines that will propel us towards a brighter future. But it's important to emphasize at this stage that innovation encompasses much more than technological advances. It includes a wide range of changes in social, economic, institutional, and environmental practices. My second message is we are making progress. With the support of FAO and various partners, nations around the world have demonstrated significant commitment to transforming agri-food systems. Since 2021, 126 countries have adopted national pathway for food system transformation, and 155 have appointed national conveners for food systems, underscoring their commitment to this cause. The last Food System Summit Plus 2 in Rome that took place in July 2023 reiterated the essential role of science and innovation in actualizing these plans. My third message is we know that innovation, to be truly impactful, must be contagious. It should inspire and spread, igniting a passion for positive change. It should be at once local, embracing frugality as much as it embraces complexity. And at the same time, it must transcend borders, connecting diverse minds and expertise from across the globe. By fostering an environment where innovative ideas flow freely and are readily shared, we can create a ripple effect of transformation that extends beyond individual efforts. My fourth point is that innovation is most potent when it's purposeful and strategic. Random, disjointed efforts might yield isolated successes, but true innovation shines when it aligns with a clear vision and mission. Rather than scattered endeavors, we should focus our innovation efforts on well-defined goals, maximizing their impact and ensuring their they contribute meaningfully to the larger objectives of sustainability and equity. And my fifth point, final point, is that innovation must be context-specific, inclusive, with the potential for having impact at scale. The effectiveness of innovation lies in its relevance to the specific needs and circumstances of individual countries and regions. What works in one context might not be suitable elsewhere. To truly address the diverse challenges faced by nations, innovation must be tailored to local priorities, challenges, and cultural values. So by taking a context-specific and inclusive approach, we ensure that innovations are not only effective, but also respectful of the unique nuances of each region's, promoting equitable and sustainable outcomes. So we can say that transforming food system is an enormous undertaking. However, it's a challenge we must address with urgency and determination. It requires a collective effort, drawing on the diverse expertise and experiences of all involved. So ladies and gentlemen, friends, colleagues, this webinar is not just a forum. It's a platform to exhibit how broad, innovative thinking can positively impact our food systems. We will share stories that illustrate how comprehensive innovation can effectively enhance food security, economic stability, and environmental sustainability. So now let me introduce our great panelists and speakers. I am very pleased to first introduce Mrs. Emma-Stella Gakwo, a leader in innovations management and entrepreneurship. Mrs. Gakwo co-founded Savannah Circuit Tech in Kenya, focusing on climate smart post-harvest management. Her work with Internet of Things enabled mobile solar coolers and dehydrators is pivotal in reducing post-harvest losses. A Royal Academy of Engineering Leaders in Innovations Fellow, she's also a dedicated advocate for frugal solutions in agri-value chains, and she serves on the board of JUSA Adapt, educating rural communities about climate change. Now I would like to move to Gladys Morales, Senior Officer and Global Head of Innovation in IFAD's Change Delivery and Innovation Unit. Mrs. Morales is a key figure in designing and implementing innovative initiatives and partnerships that directly impact poor rural people. Her role extends to serving as a regional ambassador in Italy for the Global Blockchain Business Council. And finally, we are joined here by Mr. Vivian Bordereau, the Net Zero Food System Mission Lead at EIT Food. Mr. Bordereau is driving forward innovation in the food industry to address significant environmental challenges, including greenhouse gas emission and resource depletion. His role encompasses supporting sustainable agricultural practices, reducing food waste, and promoting sustainable packaging within the circular food economy. So we have these three great panelists with us, and we are going to delve into our discussion and get into more the substance of this question of innovation around food system transformation. And I would like to ask you, you have three questions that I would like to pose. I'm going to give you these three questions, and then you feel free to focus on the three of them or to focus on some of them. And then you'll have 10 minutes for your answer before we get into a dialogue with our participants. So the three questions are the following. How can innovation in food systems play a pivotal role in changing policies and standards? The second question is innovation accessible to all? And the third question is, how can non-technological innovation accelerate transforming food systems? So you will have a chance to express your opinion and insights. You can choose, and we would appreciate if you can pick up some examples, very concrete examples. And you have 10 minutes, and I am going to start with you, Emma-Stella.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Vincent, for giving me the floor. I'm very pleased to be one of the contributors for this very important webinar series. I am from Savannah Circuit, and we deal in making sure that climate smart solutions, especially in post-harvest management, they are available, they are accessible, and also that they are applicable in the context of the people that are needed. We are great believers of Africans, innovating in Africans for Africans, but also with a global perspective. As it has already been mentioned that when deploying innovation, purpose and strategy is very, very important. And it is one of the reasons why, since our founding in 2017, we carried out extensive market research with diverse value chain stakeholders. The reason for this was to make sure that we are able to sit in where the actual problem is. And what stood out very clearly is the need for storage solutions, cold chain solutions, and to be deployed in a manner that is able to allow integration to market, integration of the smallholder farmers into the main supply chain. It is for this reason that we realized and decided that we will make the smallholder farmers the champions of what that we do. And we work with the dairy farmers in Kenya and in some select countries in East Africa. We understand that the smallholder farmers, they have very deep-rooted knowledge and understanding of ecosystem that they depend on. So it was very, very important to build with and around the existing solutions and make sure that we adequately deploy and bring proper impact to the communities that we work in. So I would like to say that innovation clearly serves as a catalyst for reshaping policies and standards within the food systems. And I'll draw some of our examples. Initially, we conducted two very successful pilots. And one of the main objectives for this was to make sure that one, we are able to clearly have the right product that is able to be deployed in the context of the smallholder farmers and the different levels of the farmers across the supply chain. So we are looking at 70% of dairy production coming from the smallholder farmers. And then we have 30% coming from commercial farmers. So it was very, very important for us to modularize some of this equipment to deploy some of the solutions, the mobile solar coolers. It was very clear that there were a lot of policy gaps that were existing, especially in hygiene practices, especially on guidelines on access to equipment, especially milk carriage equipment, because majority of our farmers were using plastic milk containers for milk storage, which are a food safety hazard. However, in this context, we were able to contribute to the dairy produce safety regulations in 2021, where we collaborated with the stakeholder or the regulator to bring in insights from the industry, from farmers, both from a private sector perspective, but also importantly, from the voices of what some of the farmers that we're working with. Even as we deploy some of our solutions, we have hardware and software solutions, and as mentioned, integrated with Internet of Things to make sure that some of our large capacity chillers are able to give real-time temperature data. Why is this important? It is important because it allows for traceability of the produce, visibility of the farmers, which will allow them to be integrated very well in the financial systems and make sure that they are able to access financing. So with this together, we see that we, as innovation is contributing to transparency, to accountability, and especially between farmers, cooperatives, who we market our product to, and who in turn are able to market the milk to the processors and also pay the farmers. So we see this data-driven approach, being able to raise cases to the stakeholder, contribute to roundtables, and bring some of our learnings. Also, innovation is able to promote climate smart practices, and especially now where there's a lot of scrutiny on farm emissions, particularly on livestock. So by us showcasing that there are solutions that are there to be applied by the people, regardless of what node they come from, whether it's at the subsistence level, commercial level farmer, that they can still be able in their own small ways to be able to adopt and adapt some of these climate smart solutions like solar powered milk chillers and other ways that we are able to optimize route mapping, minimize cost of transport and things like that. So we see through this, we continue to share these learnings with the regulator and the policymakers and the different lobby groups, how, you know, by deploying innovation, we are able to bring climate smart solution. Lastly, on innovation, promoting policy, and is that by us working by the forgotten node of the livestock sector, these are the rangeland, pastoral communities who are nomads and they move from point to point. You find that most of the time these marginalized groups, they tend to be forgotten when policies are being drafted. But by us having Working with some of the very marginalized communities, especially in camel milk supply chain, we've seen that we've shown what is possible to be done, and also a stepping ground on how to bring on board all these marginalized communities, but also most importantly, women, how they can be brought on board, not just as labor providers as they have been in the past, but also people who can be supported in these systems to make sure that they are very able to be empowered and benefit and improve their livelihoods. So I will jump in, Mr. Vincent, to the question of is innovation accessible to all? And just like you mentioned, that accessibility to innovation is a very, very critical factor. And for proper impact, it needs to be widespread. Despite Savannah Circuit being at growth stage, preparing for massive scale, one of the important things that we have been able to incorporate is affordability. Affordable and scalable business model, where, for example, farmers do not have to make upfront investments to afford some of these chillers, because they have the model of lease to own. So they pay a small monthly fee in a set period of time, and they can be able to fully afford the equipment. Also, we are able to make sure that we have drying as a service for farmers in the mango value chain, such that they do not necessarily have to acquire this equipment through cooperatives, through farmer groups. They can be able to access the services that are offered by these different equipments. We realize that as we continue working in the value chains, that it is important to educate our end users collaboratively with the regulators, with other stakeholders, to make sure that they are able to understand what is the problem, especially on food safety, post-harvest loss, and also besides having more money in their pockets by cutting the losses, but also how it is important for them to utilize these different technologies or solutions that are being deployed to them. One also of the important things to ensure accessibility is that we've been able to bring in community engagement, and this is done through trainer of trainers. So through this trainer of trainers model, I'll give an example. Say we have a region or a county that is producing dairy milk. So in this context, we give them trainer of trainers who's able to support them for troubleshooting, who is able to support them to train their plant operators and make sure that by them having support, they are able to fully utilize this equipment, not just for the benefit of making sure that we have minimized losses, but also making sure that they are able to build businesses from this. I'll give an example. Through community engagement, some of our farmers or groups, they have been able to go to the next level and become entrepreneurs, where they use some of these chillers, not just for milk aggregation at farm gates, but also use these different chillers to what is now becoming almost a new product, dispensing milk on wheels. So this is very encouraging, especially when we see the youth being able to diversify the use of the equipment, and also importantly, bringing women on board to have a side business, aside from being dairy farmers, but also sellers of dairy products. So that is very, very encouraging. Last thing in terms of accessibility is that we've been able to leverage partnerships. And this has been through government. There have been a lot of government programs that have been in the country, in the region, and we've been able to collaborate, whether it's to run pilots for awareness, for ease of adoption or case studies, but also at commercial level. We've been able to collaborate on this, as well as NGOs, international organizations. So they've been very, very helpful in enabling us to access a broader audience where we have shared value principles, and there's a win for everyone. So the last point on non-technological innovation, accelerating transformation of food systems, is that even non-technological innovation is equally crucial in driving transformative change. And I'll give an example that outside of just having the tech side of the solution, what has been very critical in our growth, and what sets us aside from some of the solution providers that we have, is because we've been able to address some of the cultural, social, and behavioral aspects. Allow me to give an example in the context of the camel milk supply chain. It's very different from the dairy. Reason being, some of the farmers do not want to mix their milk at farm gates. So what we did, we gave them food grade stainless steel cans that can be used for milking and also for transportation, but not just transportation, that they can integrate with the mobile cooler that are accessible there and make sure that the milk is able to make it to market. And also, most importantly, despite the low literacy levels, the youth that are trained to use this equipment, they're able to use. So lastly, to my last point, I would say we've seen a lot of growth, especially on the supply chain innovation end, where we see more distribution models coming up away from the standard cooperative systems that you see that they're now small traders that are coming alive from this, because now they have equipment to leverage, to become more efficient, to get licensing from the Kenya Dairy Board, for example. And this is equally very, very encouraging on how even the non-technological side of things is useful. So, and to my last point, I would say also we've seen some of the cooperatives, by having growing membership, they're now able now to even have SACCO. So SACCO is like a financial side of the business where farmers can access credit, where they can pull resources and even buy more equipment or access training from the different funds that they have. So that is what we've been able to do. And we totally agree that success of innovative solution goes beyond technology. And we promise to keep growing and providing these solutions to ensure that they benefit everyone involved, from the smallholder farmers to the end consumer. So thank you so much for your attention. Yeah, back to you, Vincent.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Emma Stella, for sharing your insight, giving very precise examples, mentioning this contribution to transparency of how you've been addressing the issue of affordability. I really like when you mentioned also that through your community engagement, you help all these users to become entrepreneurs, empowering the youth, empowering women to develop some side business. I think it was really, really powerful example. So thank you so much for answering all these different questions with a very pragmatical and concrete examples you've shared with us. Thank you so much. And now I would like to turn to Gladys. Could you share your insights on these three questions, Gladys?
Thank you so much, Vincent. Hello, everyone. And thank you not only to Vincent but for the introduction, but also to Stefanos and the team at the UN Food Systems Hub for the invitation. Before I address the questions that were posed by Vincent, I would like to very briefly introduce the International Fund for Agricultural Development, as some of you might not be as familiar with the organization, even though I can see in the participants list that a lot of you were also joining us yesterday at the Women Economic Forum. So IFAD is an international financial institution. So we are credit rated. We have a AA+ credit rating, which gives us access to capital markets. And indeed, just Monday this week, our bonds were placed in the London Stock Exchange. What that means for IFAD's beneficiaries is that that enhances our capability to mobilize resources and bring innovation to scale. So it's a very big achievement for the organization, but also a new way to do innovative finance, but also to deliver results for smallholder farmers and for vulnerable groups. So we are, as I was saying, we are both an international financial institution, but we are also a UN specialized agency. And we laser focus on smallholder farmers and vulnerable groups. There is no other UN agency that is so focused on the addressing the needs of this population. At IFAD, we indeed invest in rural people, empowering them to increase their food security, to improve the nutrition of their families and increase their incomes. And we help them to build resilience, expand their businesses, and take charge of their own development. So, to address the first question by Vincent on how innovation in food systems can play a pivotal role in changing policies and standards, I would like to focus on three main examples. So some of you might know that the small-scale farmers and small agribusinesses produce 1/3 of the world's food and up to 70% of the food in low and middle-income countries. So the role of smallholder farmers is fundamental. And yet, the new report by Climate Short Investor Coalition and the Climate Policy Initiative reveals that climate finance going to small-scale agri-food systems has gone down by 44% and is now as low as 0.8% of total climate finance, which is far below what is needed. So all the United Nations and international organizations really need to make a case at COP28 so that this situation changes. So business as usual solutions, as we were listening previously by Mirza, including the most advanced digital finance services or provenance solutions. And when I talk about provenance solutions, I'm talking about the traceability also of agricultural products. They have made progress in expanding the frontiers for financing and providing market opportunities in rural areas, but they still leave behind and in unfavorable in price-taking positions, smallholder farmers, due to high certification costs affecting transaction costs in the last mile and top-down data ownership structures. None of us, actually all of us, none of us have fully access to the ownership of our data, and we give it up constantly every time that we post pictures on Facebook or Instagram or any other social media platform. But we, in general, the people at this webinar, we're making it as part of a choice. Smallholder farmers, vulnerable groups, they don't have that opportunity. They're not making a conscious choice to share their data. And what that means is that in some cases, when there is no ethical use of the technology, instead of providing the basis to make our services more inclusive, we are effectively creating the basis to exclude them from financial services and from social services. So to address this, IFAD is working to develop solutions that address these particular issues of data security, data privacy. One of the solutions that we are developing at the moment in partnership with the Inter-American Development Bank is a digital public infrastructure. For those of you that are not familiar with what the terminology means, think of a highway. So these digital public infrastructures are like a highway. All these apps, all these digital products that you see, they would be like cars in this highway. And what this digital public infrastructure, which is, as the word says, is public, and it's a digital public good, it enhances the benefits of these apps and these products so that we can deliver better services to smallholder farmers and to vulnerable groups. But this particular DPI, digital public infrastructure, is available not only in agriculture, but in many other sectors. So the name of this digital public infrastructure is AgriWeb3, which leverages on blockchain and Web3 technologies to adapt and implement a single interoperable protocol. So it's completely, it can communicate with many different apps and products that are capitalizing on this digital public infrastructure. It's vendor agnostic, so IFAD and IDB can go to any country and decide which partner is best to engage with based on best value for money and what is the best, you know, who has the best knowledge of the local context. Because as we heard before by Vincent as well, context is extremely important, understanding the context and understand not replicating by the sake of replicating, but making sure that our solutions really address the needs of smallholder farmers is fundamental. So it's interoperable, it's vendor agnostic, and very, very importantly, it helps to cut down the transaction costs, intermediary costs. So we are, this is not a dream, this is already happening. The platform leverages on the experience and the knowledge of blockchain, which is one of the most successful digital assets of the Inter-American Development Bank. It's already reaching almost 9 million people and cutting costs down from the regular cost of a blockchain certificate for agricultural production, for provenance, or for academic credentials, or for you know, the origin of fertilizers, from the market cost of between $20 to $180 per certificate to only 30 cents or 50 cents per certificate. So great gains also for the people that are part of the beneficiaries in these projects. So that's AgriWeb3. So that's an example of a technology. A second example is Land Monitor. This is a project that is a baby of one of our IFAD innovation challenges. Land Monitor is a project that IFAD co-led with the International Land Coalition and the Land Tenure Desk of the International Fund for Agricultural Development. This particular project is not really technology based. It's a change in the approach of how is that we work with communities, with the stakeholders to improve data collection and evidence gathering so that we can influence policy making. So this is Land Monitor. The beauty of Land Monitor is that it was a project that was developed with the communities, but particularly with women. So when we meet with the team, I always enjoy when they present the project and they say this is really a project that is by women, with women, and for women. They are engaged completely in the whole process of design, delivery, and also in the negotiations with the local communities, but also influencing the strategy in the country. So one of the main findings of Land Monitor was that when you give women access to land tenure, agricultural productivity, in fact, increases. So that's a very strong message. And with data and with evidence, we are able to influence the policy and the national strategy. In the case of Land Monitor, it was implemented in the Philippines, but we are now replicating also in countries in South America, aiming to also replicate in Africa. So let me move from technology and innovative approaches to, even though we have partnerships in everything, partnerships are at the core of everything that we do at IFAD in terms of innovation. This is a very particular partnership. It's called 3FS within the financing agenda. IFAD and the World Bank have developed a tool to measure financial flows to food systems. IFAD is really aiming to be a fully data-driven, evidence-based organization. So for us to develop these partnerships for better data gathering, for better decision making based on evidence is fundamental. So the 3FS provides real-time information on food system financing at country and global levels. It enables decision makers to track the allocation of resources, but also to optimize financial flows. And what that means effectively is that, as you know, we have donor fatigue. So by initiatives like 3FS, but also by innovative financing mechanisms like the ones that IFAD is developing and placing in international capital markets, we are looking for new ways to mobilize resources and to bring scale to innovation. So that brings me to question number two, which is innovation accessible to all? I won't dedicate much time to this one because, yes, innovation is...
You have used your 10 minutes, Gladys. Can you just summarize?
I'll wrap up. So yeah. Very, very, very quickly on innovation. Innovation, we have seen anyone can be an innovator. What we are missing is scaling up innovation. And for that, financial resources are extremely necessary. Those partnerships and bringing together that capacity is necessary. So I'll conclude with that, Vincent. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Gladys. And maybe during the question and answers, there will be opportunities to develop on some other aspects you wanted to mention. I'm now going to move to Vivian. Vivian, can you share your insight with us?
Sure, of course. Thanks for having me, and thanks for the invite. I'm glad to be here representing EIT Food and to shine a light on our EIT Food activities helping transforming the food system. So a quick word on EIT Food. We are a food innovation community. We are linked to the EIT, the European Institute of Innovation and Technology, and we have a mandate to address food system challenges. So as you introduced in your introduction, Vincent, there's no shortage of challenges in the food system, unfortunately, linked to society, to the environment, or to the lack of entrepreneurial support. So at EIT Food, we create connection across the value chain, and we create bridges between startup and corporates, between consumers and industry, between research and action, and ultimately between the present and the future. So our goal is to shape the future of food, and we cannot do that without policies. And to illustrate what we do in that space, I like to take the images of a community garden, and would like you to picture a vibrant garden where there will be, you know, a corner where fruit and veg are grown, maybe some flowers, and a big tree in the middle that will symbolize all the rules associated to all this garden is run. And the community that, you know, the gardeners that are involved, one day decide to plant new seeds. And in time, these new seeds take root and show that by doing new things, you can make the whole ecosystem stronger, healthier, feeding the soil, and ultimately making stronger the big three. In time, the local council that oversees the community garden noticed what you have been doing and start to realize that by adopting new practices, it could benefit the whole community, and maybe those ideas should be replicated. So at EIT Food, we are like those gardeners. We plant and nurture ideas to transform how we get and consume food. We invest in projects, in organization and people too, that share our goal for a healthy and sustainable food system. So recent example of activities we have done that I would like to bring into focus are in the space of alternative protein, where there's a huge need to diversify the protein intake of the global population, a shift from animal-based protein to more sustainable ones. So we do a lot of work working on with academia, with industry to test some ideas around insect food, algae, plant-based milk, you name it. And what we do is not only work in isolation, we also share our learning. I like what Emma Stella said earlier, it's very important to test, but also to share and disseminate. So in 2022, we created a think tank on protein diversification and published a white paper and recently a policy brief on what we believe are the policies that should be adopted by European policymakers to accelerate protein diversification in Europe and beyond, and how this could new sort of protein could become mainstream. So that's one of the examples. I invite you to access this paper on our website. And that's one of the many things that we do in the sustainable area. So all of this dissemination of knowledge is important, dissemination of results. And to all of that sounds great, but there's a key question that you ask, Vincent, is innovation accessible to all? And we all know that innovation is vital as we work to transform the food system. But for this to happen, we need to do a lot of work to foster diversity, inclusivity, and for democratization of knowledge. At the moment, there's a huge discrepancy across the world, and initiatives such as EIT Food online courses, massive open online courses that provide baseline knowledge about food, or it grows, or it affects your health, and bring you some concept of circular economy and sustainability, could provide people of all social economic levels to engage in innovation. Those courses allow people to access knowledge, but also to gain key life skills essential for gaining an entrepreneurship mindset. I'm talking about critical thinking, I'm talking about problem solving and design thinking that are the motor of innovation. So education is key to empower people to ultimately drive innovation. So I mentioned these online courses that are for citizens of all ages. I also mentioned in my introduction that we have a lack of entrepreneurship. Only 4% of the startups globally are in the food industry, and most of them fail within 1 year of implementation. So how can we make sure that we give the right ingredients to those young entrepreneurs or entrepreneurs to create and sustain their business? So tackling the issue of diversity in the food sector and this lack of entrepreneurship, we develop a program that's trying to two birds with one stone, tackling the lack of entrepreneurship and trying to address the lack of female representation in leadership in agri-food companies. And we develop a program called EWA, Empowering Women in Agriculture, with the aim to tailor training dedicated to the needs of this entrepreneur that may be isolated, work in rural area, and have limited access to education. So we try to understand their needs and develop one-to-one mentoring, online and in-person training, as well as facilitate access to funding for their business idea to become realities. So we started small in two countries, in Poland and Spain, in 2020, and now from a cohort of 30 female entrepreneurs, we are up to more than 200 in 11 countries, mostly in Eastern Europe, Mediterranean, and in the Baltic. And thanks to this program, more than 20 businesses were created, one of them raising more than 1 million euros. So going back to my image of the garden earlier, In nature, plants will grow if you expose them to sunlight and give them some water. Not too much, not too little. And I like to think people thrive in the right condition too. So it's important to understand the needs of everyone and to adapt accordingly to unlock innovation. And this innovation does not have to be based on technology. We see a lot of the ways of AI, machine learning, Internet of Things, a lot of these making the headlines, precision farming, automated robots. But other type of instruments, non-technological innovation can have a significant impact too. Gladys mentioned finance. Financial innovation can have a key role in the future to transition to sustainable food system, whether it is a new policies innovation through subsidies or compensation scheme for farmers, or new sustainability-linked loans that finance institutions will grant and link to environmental impact. So there are some great instruments that could be used and could also drive a lot of change without requiring high-tech equipment. So I'm aware that my time bank is running out. So to finish, I would like to say that driving change do not necessarily require high-tech equipment, rather a change of approach, of attitude, of mindset. And ultimately, that's what is most needed to drive innovation. So thank you for your attention, and I look forward for the Q&A now.
Thank you so much, Vivian. Very interesting also insight on different perspective, how you act as a connectors as well with different stakeholders, your role as a gardeners. I think it was quite a powerful image. And how do you create the right ecosystem for this innovation to really have the power to leverage the new knowledge? And you mentioned education, the work you are doing on entrepreneurship. Very, very inspiring, very, very interesting from really, I understand, from very concrete projects on empowering women on creating their own business to things more on the policy, at the policy level, trying to influence policies by doing these papers on protein diversification. So really, really interesting insights. So now I think we have a bit of time for question and answers. So don't hesitate either to bring your contribution to the discussion or to ask a specific question to one of our panelists. So are we seeing some question? Some hands.
Bon, Sandra is Fatima, and Amdullah from the raise hand column, and okay. Some question in the chat. We also sent you on our group.
Okay, sorry, I didn't see it. So so we can have the first intervention. Please go ahead. I mean, the one was.
Mesa Tahir, you should be able to speak now. Yes.
So we are listening to you, Fatima.
Okay, you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank you so much for this very interesting topic and the meeting. My answer for the first question, yes, innovation can influence policies and strategies. And even in our country, in Sudan, and there is a very big difference between agricultural and production policies before the food system initiative and after that. We developed a very ambitious strategy till 2030. And in each topic, under each topic and track, we put innovation because it is very important. Sudan is facing a low productivity. Although we have abundant resources, but still the productivity is under the research results. So the other point is about the indigenous knowledge. The producers and farmers, by the way, they have some knowledge and innovation, indigenous innovation, that may be in sometimes more than we have as agricultural studies, agricultural officials. So we have to advance and to develop this indigenous knowledge so as to be used to improve the productivity, to get rid of pest diseases and AIDS, or all the challenges that facing agri-food system. Also, we have to embed this innovation in all the agriculture system, from the production to market to consumers. I attended a very interesting conference here in Saudi about how we can use food as medicine. Very interesting, because food can be used as drugs. Instead of drugs, food can be used as protection from, as my sister say, from communicable diseases. And even they start to implement this the results of the seminar, and there is a good output about that. This one point. The other point, yes, some farmers cannot access innovations, especially small-scale farmers who are the main concern for us as a food security practitioners and stakeholders. In terms of finance, for example, in Sudan, we have many banks that support the agriculture and the production of livestock, but we need some innovation in how the small farmers can access this finance, agricultural finance. This is one point. The other point is that, yes, innovation can transform food, agri-food system, because it improves the productivity. It improves even the quality and the quantity of food. So yes, innovation. We have very good experience, as my colleague from IFAD say, in Sudan, on IFAD innovations, and we get a very good production from the schemes or the projects that they are financing. I think if we think about game changing, as it is one of the food system objectives, this game changing cannot be applied or cannot be achieved without innovation. Thank now, you. Innovation a hot issue, Fatima. Just like yes.
Fatima, I think you it was really, you have asked a few very good questions. I would like to give the floor also to other participants and then back to the panelists. Okay. Your intervention was really, really rich, very Thanks. Interesting about indigenous knowledge, about the food used as medicine, how to the importance of using a value chain approach in the agricultural innovation system, the issues of accessibility. So all this was very, very relevant. And I think some of our speakers would like to react to that. But maybe before getting back to the panelists, we also have a few questions from the chat. And I don't know if, Aruna, you want to pick up one of these questions, and then we will get back to the panelists.
I can read it for the panelists, Vincent, and hopefully maybe you or, of course, our panelists may want to decide to, how to respond it and who will respond it. So we have a question from, I hope I pronounce it well, Wagdi Halkadazi. Integration of these technological dimensions into agriculture can contribute to success by increasing productivity, improving product quality, reducing cost and risk, saving limited resources, and enhancing environmental sustainability. But are there any dimensions to setting possible direction for the sake of indigenous people in order to guarantee their rights at the beginning of future transformation before technology and agriculture? So maybe we can ask quickly our colleagues to respond to that.
Absolutely, and I think there are also some connections with the previous intervention from Fatima on this indigenous knowledge. And just, I would like just to pick up one more before getting back to the panelists. I think this question was directed to Vivian from Gupta G about FAO IMRA is undertaking a training presently with the aspect you have mentioned. This is a system design training hosted on the FAO Virtual CERN Learning Center. Et cetera. So I guess maybe that's something you can look in the chat and see if you can respond to this one. So back to the panelists, if you can give us a quick feedback on these two questions that were raised. And maybe Emma Stella, would you like to give it a shot? Because you had a lot to say on accessibility, affordability, etc.
Yeah, sure, Vincent. That's a really important question, and I agree, especially for people who are bringing new innovations that are to benefit the indigenous, the marginalized, the people at the lowest points of the value chain. It is important from the onset to bring them on board. For example, from focus groups where they could give feedback, and not sometimes what we've seen in the past, that you have maybe some stakeholders organization, they come in, collect the data and go, and no feedback that comes from it. But I would say co-developing, just maybe how Gladys had mentioned, co-developing some of these innovations or approaches together with the indigenous is very, very important. But also not just from the point of the need to deploy a new innovation, but also how could we leverage and integrate existing traditional knowledge, combine that with tech, and I'll be able to deploy a holistic solution. So I think this is an all hands on deck for everyone to be able to make sure that this happens well and everybody is involved from the onset, even towards the skill and the future transformations within the food systems.
We cannot hear you, Vincent.
Sorry, I was on mute. Yeah, I wanted to turn back to you, Gladys, and hear your reflections on these various questions.
Let me pick the one about the combination of indigenous knowledge and innovation. So as I was sharing before, one of the things that we do at IFAD is the holistic approach of our innovation model, which also includes behavioral science. So one of the things that we realize with behavioral science is that, yes, we need to be aware of the context and just not replicating innovations that are working in one place and just bringing them and catapulting them in new realities just for the sake of it and for the sake of scalability. But we really need to understand the context and whether those solutions are going to work in the particular context. So one way of doing that, understanding the context, understanding the culture, is through behavioral insights. But there was very little evidence or robust evidence that those connections were indeed connections. So one thing that IFAD and the Green Climate Fund did is that we developed an evidence gap map to check with evidence on the links between impact and between behavioral insights in the design of our projects. And we in fact found out that when reminders and feedback are given in a continuous basis and in a systematic way in our projects, we do have better results and better chances at delivering impact. So that's one of the ways of doing it. And through that community-based approach and working with indigenous people, sometimes, you know, I want to clarify, it's not that innovation is not accessible to everyone. We adhere to the United Nations 2.0 vision that anyone can be an innovator. And yesterday, for those people that are here and we're at the Women Economic Forum, we have data that shows that, you know, for nascent, you can go for thousands of dollars for something small. For when you're replicating, it can be millions of dollars. But if you want scalability, there is no other way than go with major financing. And for major financing and scalability at that global level, you need a lot of resources, billions of dollars for that level of scalability. Thank you, Vincent.
Thank you so much, Gladys. Before we close this meeting, because we are soon coming to an end, there were several hands raised. So let's take one more question from the floor, and I think I could give the floor to Mary, if you can hear me. Mary, you are mute. I don't know if you can because you raised your hand. So I was wondering. Otherwise, we can go to Gupta.
Okay, yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. Thank you for the opportunity, Vincent. I have been posting on the chat, assuming that I may not get a chance to speak. So I have a question for Vivian and a comment for Gladys. Vivian, it was very interesting to hear of the trainings that you spoke about. I happen to be one of the designers and the trainers for the FAO INRAE training on sustainable and local food systems. May I request if you could send a link on the chat to the training that you speak about? It will be very interesting to take a look about the training and see if there are any synergies. For Gladys, there is a message on the chat. The IFAD innovation team got in touch with us to participate in this training, but unfortunately, they were too late for the application in 2023. On 2nd of December, we are closing this training. And it's a good opportunity for IFAD colleagues to come and take a look at the summary of the training. We have five teams across multiple countries and five sets of innovation challenges for food systems transformation they're working on. Perhaps it's something that you may like to revisit and observe on 2nd of December. Thank you so much.
And you had a question to Vivian.
Yes, well, absolutely, Gupta. Thanks for reaching out. We are all about collaboration at EIT Food. In fact, I know about the FAO online course. I follow them. I follow one of them myself for my personal development. So we are all about collaboration, as I mentioned. And coming back to the online course of EIT Food, we really believe that they are key to spread knowledge and to basically a key instrument to leave no one behind. And to that extent, we provide these free courses with free certification. Targeting, you know, anyone really, but the students that want to demonstrate knowledge before going to a master, or the teachers that want to cascade learning in class, or professionals that want to upskill, reskill, or change career. So we really have content adapted to all citizens, and we have reached 250,000 person in 5 years. So our courses are very engaging, short format. We are showing rather than telling, using a lot of case studies from real businesses, and I believe they are of very great quality. So I encourage you to have a look. I will share the link in the chat now, and I'm open to any kind of collaboration. So please, yes, via LinkedIn or any other platform. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Vivian. I think we are reaching the end. Can Arina, do we have time for one last contribution or question, or we just have to close the...
You manage 1 minute contribution and 2 minutes closure. That's good. I think that's great.
Yeah, let's go maybe to Ambula Mame. If you can hear us, you raise your hand. If you can say one contribution, and I will be super short for my conclusion.
Yes, I actually have a question, and it was specifically to IFAD. I was asking regarding non-technological innovation. What is IFAD doing, IFAD and similar organizations that support developing countries with agriculture programs, what are you doing to ensure that your programs in those countries complement each other, that they are sequenced and layered with each other and leverage the advantages of each other to address the underlying problem? What we are experiencing is different projects in different regions by different organizations. If they can be layered and sequenced, and they can be able to address the problem more effectively. So I wanted to know, what are you doing regarding that? And if you're already doing it, can you just point to one example that I can reference and read about? Thank you.
That is your 30 seconds.
So let me, in 30 seconds, the only thing that I can say is I would like to follow up with you directly. And we do have a lot of examples in our South-to-South in triangular cooperation program, also in cooperation and partnership with FAO. And please do check IFAD's Rural Solutions Portal. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you so much. We are coming to an end of this webinar. It was extremely rich, fantastic. I would like to say a big thanks to our speakers. They were straight to the point. They gave very good examples. I think it generated a lot of interest and questions in the chat. I'm sure the colleagues, Aruna, Baruta, they will be able to follow up on some of these things. And yes, I would like to thank you. I think this conversation on innovation, non-technological innovation, the ecosystem of innovation is just the beginning of this conversation for this food system transformation. But at the same time, even it's not really the beginning, but it's something that we need to accelerate progress on that and really need to impact that scale. So I would just like to encourage you to apply all this knowledge and techniques and discussion we have had today and in other forum to your own work. And then we will continue this conversation to make sure that we can make progress in agri-food system transformation. And with this, I would like to say a big thank you to the organizer, big thank you to the audience, and have a nice day.
Thank you, Vincent. Thank you to the organizers.
Thank you.
And to the audience. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
We have the UN Food Systems Coordination Hub for this excellent and successful webinar. And stay tuned on our website to see our next webinar series. Thanks to all.